Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Paddleways of Mississippi, Rivers and People of the Magnolia State by Ernest Herndon and Patrick Parker, narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Eventually, all things merge into one, and a river runs through it. Norman MacLean. Introduction. I started out thinking of America as highways and state lines. As I got to know it better, I began to think of it as rivers. Charles Kuralt. The navigable rivers and creeks of the state of Mississippi have been foundational in every aspect of the state's geology, ecology, settlement, development, economy, and politics. These paddleways of Mississippi, its rivers, creeks, and streams, as well as lakes, bays, and swamps, are its arteries, its lifeblood, and the connective tissue that holds its stories and histories together. In prehistory, the area that would eventually become the state of Mississippi was covered by a shallow sea. As that sea receded, it left a low, largely flat plain that accumulated plant debris over the years. Wind rushing down what would become the Mississippi River Valley deposited fine glacier ground dust to form many feet of loess soil, which was then cut into hills and hollows by rills and rivulets, leaving the terrain that is familiar to us throughout all of Mississippi, except for the Appalachian foothills in the farthest northeast corner of the state. Native Americans traveled and settled along these waterways, which they used for drinking, cooking, and irrigation, as well as for navigation. The Poverty Point culture grew up throughout the lower Mississippi River Valley and Gulf Coast region, only to be supplanted by other tribes and cultures, including the Yazoo, Natchez, Choctaw, and Chickasaw. Naniwaya, the source of the Pearl River in central Mississippi, figures prominently in the origin stories of the Choctaw, Chickasaw, and other tribes. European-descended Americans moved into the Mississippi Territory in steam-powered boats and paddlecraft, and they expanded into the territory on the smaller navigable waterways. French and Spanish explorers plied the navigable waters of Mississippi. Political treaties and boundaries were based on the locations of streams and rivers. Even the current political boundaries of the state of Mississippi were based to a large extent on the courses of the Mississippi, Pearl, and Tennessee rivers. Rivers and creeks dictated the construction and placement of roadways because people could only ford or bridge or ferry a river at naturally occurring places of convenience. Settlers and soldiers traversed the Natchez Trace, the Three Chopped Way, and the Old Federal Road, all of which passed over, around, or through countless streams to end at Natchez overlooking the Mississippi River. The construction of dams on the rivers and creeks of Mississippi further influenced the development of the communities around those rivers. Commerce took place by way of rivers, including but not limited to the mighty Mississippi, as evidenced by the legal definition of navigable waters in the Mississippi Code of Laws. All rivers, creeks, and bayous in this state, 25 miles in length, that have sufficient depth and width of water for 30 consecutive days in the year for floating a steamboat with carrying capacity of 200 bales of cotton, are hereby declared to be navigable waters of this state. During the 1700s and 1800s, Natchez, situated in the southwest corner of the territory, became one of the major commercial centers of the hemisphere solely because of its location near prime cotton-growing land in Mississippi and Louisiana, and near the commercial artery that was the Mississippi River. A handful of rivers of Mississippi played an outsized role in the Civil War. Decisive battles were fought at the Big Black and all along the Yazoo and its tributaries. Prisoners of war were kept for a short time at a horrific makeshift prison in a ruined covered bridge over the Pearl River in Jackson. Perhaps the most crippling blow of the entire war was dealt to the Confederacy at the confluence of the Yazoo and Mississippi Rivers when Vicksburg fell to a Union siege. The rivers, especially the Mississippi, also influenced the movement and speciation of wildlife. A prime example is the black bear, populations of which thrived in Louisiana's Tensas River region on the west side of the Mississippi, but which declined east of the river until they were on the brink of extirpation in our state. Bears have since expanded back into Mississippi and are making a remarkable comeback, particularly along the river bottoms throughout the state. Panther, white-tailed deer, alligator, and bald eagle populations have followed similar patterns as black bears in the Mississippi River Valley. Ecological issues also follow the courses of rivers, including erosion and habitat loss from clear-cutting and channelization, nitrate runoff followed by algal bloom, and dead zones as a result of agricultural overfertilization and sewage lagoon spillage. Any river that runs through a metropolitan area, like the Pearl River does through Jackson, will also have the problems of plastic and styrofoam pollution, as well as oil and gasoline runoff from roads and parking lots. Note: ecologically, things are looking pretty bright for the paddleways of Mississippi. Recent decades have seen improvements in forestry practices, erosion control measures, municipal and residential wastewater treatment, and pollution. However, considering that Mississippi's ribbons of water drain 48,430 square miles populated by 3 million people, they remain inherently fragile. The biggest threats currently include channelization, dams, erosion, flood control projects, invasive species, species decline, logging, and oil spills. Because the rivers and creeks of Mississippi were so instrumental in the development of every aspect of the state, one of the best ways to understand Mississippi is to investigate the social, ecological, and oral histories of the peoples and communities that dot the state's navigable waterways. These are the stories of the people of the Paddleways of Mississippi. Note: some of the material for this book is adapted, updated, and restructured from content, articles, chapters, columns, and posts previously published in Ernest Herndon's books Canoeing Mississippi, Canoeing Louisiana, and Paddling the Pascagoula, co-authored with Scott B. Williams, on Patrick Parker's blog, roamingparkers.com, and in the outdoor and nature writing of both authors in local magazines and newspapers, particularly the Macomb, Mississippi Enterprise Journal. The Mississippi River. With us, when you speak of the river, though there be many, you mean always the same one, the great river, the shifting, unappeasable god of the country, feared and loved, the Mississippi. William Alexander Percy. The Mississippi River Basin is one of the largest river systems in the world, draining 31 U.S. states and two Canadian provinces, totaling almost 1.3 million square miles. The river drains 41% of the area of the contiguous United States. Meandering more than 2,350 miles from its source at Lake Itasca in Minnesota to the Gulf of Mexico south of New Orleans, it defines the borders of 10 U.S. states, including Mississippi, which lays claim to about 410 miles of the namesake river's length. At the headwaters at Lake Itasca, the river is quite shallow and is narrow enough to flow through a culvert, but it collects the waters of many tributaries, including the Ohio, Missouri, Arkansas, White, Yazoo, and Red. As it nears its mouth at New Orleans, it sprawls more than a mile wide and 200 feet deep in places. Note: the word Mississippi is derived from an Ojibwe Indian phrase meaning simply Big River. Because many tribes lived along it, it has gone by many names, including Chukaga, Tamalisiu, Nilko, Miko, Okachita, Olsimachita, Namosi Sipu, Sasagula, and Kulata. Spanish explorers ignored the native names, calling it Espiritu Santo or Rio Grande. But when French explorers journeyed down the river from Canada, they took the label they'd learned from the northern Indians, for whom Miss meant big and Sipi was river. Over the course of millennia, the Mississippi River has wandered to and fro across the land, periodically flooding and receding and relentlessly reshaping the terrain. It is easy to see on a modern satellite map just where the Mississippi has strayed eastward, then westward back and forth, leaving snaky scars across what would become the southern United States. Note: the Mississippi Petrified Forest in Flora, now almost 50 miles east of the river, contains fossils of ancient sequoia trees that could only have come from the extreme northwest parts of the Mississippi watershed. They probably washed here from the Dakotas via the raging glacier-fed floodwaters that formed the Missouri River. In its passing, the big river carved steep bluffs and left behind a giant floodplain full of rich alluvial soil. In its current course, the river passes through two distinct geographic regions of the state of Mississippi: the floodplain, largely north of Vicksburg, in places 50 to 100 miles wide, and the lowest bluffs to the south, in places 200 to 300 feet high. In its endless shifting, the Mississippi helped carve what would become the Coldwater, Yallabusha, Tallahatchie, Yazoo, and Sunflower Rivers out of the floodplain east of the river, an area now known as the Mississippi Delta. The endless flooding, receding, and shifting have also made human habitation along the river impermanent, except for a handful of communities of the most tenacious people who settled in the most fortuitous spots along the river. As a result of these vagaries, right along the river you mostly find only ghost towns or tiny unincorporated communities. Most of the larger, more permanent settlements lie either miles back away from the flooding meanderings of the river, north of Vicksburg, or else high above the river on bluffs, Vicksburg and south. Now, only a few towns in the 410-mile-long Mississippi State segment actually border the waterway. Note: the Mississippi River has been called a wilderness between the levees, and the Audubon Society goes further and deems it a river of birds, as 60% of America's songbirds and 44% of migrating waterfowl use the Mississippi Flyway as a major migratory route. Audubon has designated important bird areas throughout the state, including Yazoo National Wildlife Refuge, Vicksburg National Military Park, St. Catherine Creek National Wildlife Refuge, Shipland Wildlife Management Area, and Eagle Lake, among others. It's not uncommon to see herons, eagles, pelicans, and killdeer throughout the year. River models. For the last couple hundred years, humans have tried, with varying degrees of success, to force the river to stay put in the course that is familiar and convenient to us. It has been said that in order to control something, one has to be able to measure it, and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers' attempts to measure and control the Mississippi River in the pre-computer era involved elaborate physical hydraulic models of the river basin constructed from concrete and corrugated metal. Once these accurately scaled models were built, engineers could flush hundreds of gallons of water at a time through them and see what flooded and what flowed like they wanted it to. They could make tiny physical changes to their models and predict the effects of construction projects on the actual river. The river flood model at Vicksburg was constructed in the late 1930s as a proof of concept. A Macomb, Mississippi Enterprise Journal article dated January 9, 1939, describes the model as stretching out over 245 acres, a perfect outdoor model of the Mississippi River covering 602 miles of the main river from Helena, Arkansas, south to the Gulf, together with the five principal tributaries, all backwater areas, and the entire Atchafalaya Basin to the Gulf of Mexico, covering a total area of 16,000 square miles. Over the next three decades, the prototype Vicksburg model was used successfully to predict the results of flood control efforts, while a more extensive model was being constructed by thousands of German and Italian World War II prisoners of war and hundreds of Corps of Engineers employees at Clinton. In 1948, a popular science magazine article about this largest-scale model in the world projected that this effigy of Old Man River is expected to make him behave better. When completed, the World War II-era Mississippi River Basin model at Clinton accurately modeled the majority of the basin, accounting for the flow and drainage of everything from Nebraska to the Great Lakes and south to the Gulf of Mexico. The first official use of the completed model was in the spring of 1952, when it was put through 16 days of 24-hour nonstop testing to predict flood stages in Nebraska and Missouri. The results of this initial round of modeling are estimated to have prevented flood damages exceeding $65 million. Despite being declared surplus with the advent of computer modeling, the hydraulic river model at Clinton was called back into operation as late as the mid-1970s in response to flood control questions. Now the remains of the long mothballed model lie within the bounds of Buddy Butts Park in Clinton and are overgrown with trees and brush, scrawled with graffiti, and dotted with burned-out hobo campfires. In more recent years, there have been efforts by university architecture and engineering students, along with the Friends of the Mississippi River Basin Model Group, to clean and rehabilitate parts of the site for educational purposes. Memphis also has an educational, quarter-mile-long scale model of the lower third of the Mississippi River at a city park on Mud Island, as well as a museum of river history there. The city had this model built in concrete at a scale of 30 inches to the mile, which renders the entire river from Cairo, Missouri to New Orleans. In addition to the models at Clinton and Memphis, the Corps of Engineers, in collaboration with other government agencies, has the not-to-be-missed Lower Mississippi River Museum and Riverfront Interpretive Site on Levee Street in Vicksburg, with a theater, exhibits, a dry-docked boat to explore, and a quarter-acre flowing hydraulic model of a section of the river. Two blocks away, the flood wall is covered with hundreds of feet of historical murals. Navigation on the Mississippi. The Mississippi River is not the sort of place most paddlers go for a Saturday float. In fact, some folks advise against paddling it at all. However, humans have plied paddlecraft on the Mississippi River since time immemorial, and they're still doing it. Note: the museum at the Poverty Point World Heritage Site in Epps, Louisiana, has copper artifacts that, according to metallurgical analysis, could have only come from the northern Midwest of the United States or from the eastern maritime provinces of Canada. So the people of the Poverty Point culture, 1730 to 1350 BC, must have been navigating and trading along the Mississippi River Valley, certainly as far as the Great Lakes region, and perhaps farther. Around 1540, Hernando de Soto and his bloodthirsty army of gold-seeking Spaniards passed through North Mississippi. Contrary to popular opinion, de Soto did not discover the Mississippi, even from a European perspective. Earlier Spaniards had found it from the Gulf of Mexico. De Soto landed near what is now Tampa, Florida, hacked his way north to Tallahassee, veered northeast into the Appalachians as far north as Knoxville, Tennessee, then back south into Alabama near Montgomery, up the Tombigbee River, and across northeast Mississippi to the Mississippi River. He crossed the Mississippi River somewhere around Walls, Mississippi, just south of Memphis, then looped into Arkansas and back to the river around Port Gibson. In 1682, French explorer Robert de La Salle came down the Mississippi River celebrating Easter Mass on the high bluff at modern-day Fort Adams in Wilkinson County. In 1699, Pierre Le Moyne, Sieur d'Iberville, explored along the Gulf Coast and up the lower Mississippi River. In the Natchez area, he found the countryside pretty well settled by native inhabitants, with fields, roads, and hamlets. If you had paddled the river in frontier times, you'd have encountered dugout canoes, plank piros, log rafts, flatboats, keelboats, and shantyboats. Later, steamboats came along, littering the bottom with their wrecks, often due to fire from overheated boilers. Nowadays, in addition to towboats pushing barges, you'll encounter flat-bottom fishing boats, workboats servicing the usually stationary government dredges that keep the channel clear, paddle-wheel cruise boats, moored gambling boats, and perhaps the occasional canoe, kayak, or yacht. All of these share the river with abundant bird life, such as white pelicans, hawks, seagulls, terns, ducks, geese, and turkeys, as well as herds of deer and wild hogs, beavers watching from bank holes, and foxes. Note: in 1984, one father and son traveled pioneer style from Idaho to New Orleans. The late Bob Hardison and his 13-year-old son Casey crossed the continent Lewis and Clark style, wearing buckskins and carrying muzzle-loading weapons and other old-timey accoutrements. Traveling up the Spokane River, across Lake Coeur d'Alene and Lake Ponderay, and up Clark Fork River to the Continental Divide in Montana, the pair mounted their 16-foot cedar canoe to a homemade trolley, erected a mast and canvas, and literally sailed across the divide, walking alongside it. They struck the Jefferson River, floating into the headwaters of the Missouri, down into the Mississippi, and all the way to New Orleans. Currents and towboats. The current of the Mississippi is so strong that paddlecraft headed downstream can easily cover 20 to 35 miles a day, while paddlers intent on making time could conceivably cover 75 to 100 miles. Mississippi author Scott B. Williams averaged 50 miles a day in a sea kayak when he paddled from Minnesota to Vicksburg. Sometimes upstream eddies can feel nearly as strong as downstream flow. Dangerous whirlpools can occur when an eddy meets the main channel as the two currents collide. Whirlpools may also appear downstream from bridge pilings and rock jetties and at the mouths of rivers. Buoys marking the main river channel create miniature torrents as they bob up and down in the rushing current. Wind poses hazards too, especially when it's out of the south against the current, whipping the river into whitecaps. The nearly constant stream of towboats pushing barges, 30 or 40 at a time, day and night, also contributes to the chaotic turbulence of the river. Driftwood Johnny's River Gator Guide. The best source of information on paddling the Mississippi River, bar none, is John Ruskie's incredible River Gator website, rivergator.org. The full title is River Gator, Lower Mississippi River Water Trail. The website has numerous segments on topics such as safety techniques, side trips, reading the river, avoiding towboats, and much more, along with maps and hundreds of photos. Although it's billed as a paddler's guide, it's of value to anyone who gets out on the big river, no matter the boat. Note: John Ruskie began giving guided canoe tours on the Mississippi in 1992 and opened the Quapaw Canoe Company in Clarksdale in 1998. Ruskie, nicknamed Driftwood Johnny, is now considered a world-class expert on the Mississippi River. He has been featured in magazines such as National Geographic Adventure, Outside, and Reader's Digest. His customers come from all over the world to float the big river. He's formed a nonprofit organization, the Lower Mississippi River Foundation, to promote and preserve the river, and hosts a student apprenticeship program known as the Mighty Quapaws. The Foundation's main work since completion of the River Gator Guide is producing the annual Mississippi River Summer Camps, the first ever youth camps held entirely on the biggest river in North America. Ruskie has also taught workshops on building dugout canoes as far away as Washington State. And he is a talented blues musician, watercolor artist, map maker, and writer, having written articles, blogs, and books. Note: Ruskie acquired his knowledge the hard way. As a young man from Colorado, he rafted the Mississippi River until he collided with a pylon. After a five-month journey from Minnesota's North Woods in 1982 to 83, my best friend and I wrecked our 12-by-24-foot raft on a pylon supporting a TVA power line, he writes. The snarling water wrapped our invincible raft around the base of the tower and snapped it like a potato chip. It was February and we weren't in wetsuits. I shouldn't even be alive now to tell this story. Helping other people avoid such a fate is part of his reason for producing the River Gator Guide. Ruskie admits right off that most people consider paddling the Mississippi River to be crazy. He writes in the introduction, "If you ask anyone who lives along the lower Mississippi River, is it safe to paddle on the Mississippi River? The answer you're most likely to receive is, are you nuts? Have you lost your mind? It's crazy to paddle on the Mississippi River. You won't come back." He goes on, "Is this right? Well, yes and no. Yes, the Mississippi River is notoriously hazardous. And yes, unfortunately, a lot of people have gone out and not come back. The river and its tributaries have probably claimed more lives than all other rivers in North America put together. But no, it's not crazy. Maybe it could be considered extreme. After all, we're talking about the biggest volume river in this quadrant of the planet. You have to do it right." Ruskie compares it to paddling places like the Great Lakes or the Colorado River through the Grand Canyon, or to climbing high mountains. Dangerous but doable with the right know-how and equipment. Ruskie said he considered writing a conventional guidebook at first. "But somehow, the more I got into it, the more I saw and realized what's there, and it just seemed a disservice to the river not to do a really good job," he said. "It's the Mississippi, and it seems like the Mississippi deserved as much attention as I could feasibly give and my family would allow me to." Ruskie has also produced a series of colorful, artistic maps that accompany the River Gator Guide. The maps show a creative spirit reminiscent of the great Mississippi nature artist Walter Anderson, his biggest artistic influence, and a level of detail that recalls Mark Twain's Life on the Mississippi. To make his maps, Ruskie started by tracing the course of the river from U.S. Geological Survey maps and double-checked them with Google Earth maps and aerial photos. Then came the art. The last layer, which no one else can add to a project like this, is our personal experience on the river, seeing which channels are actually open and which actually exist, Ruskie said. And feel, too. Like any maps, there are interpretations of what's there. The maps, which come in a variety of sizes and are for sale on Ruskie's website, are on waterproof paper that can be rolled or folded. "I got the coloring from my many years of watercolor paintings of landscapes on the river," Ruskie said. "It's taken me almost 2 decades to come up with a palette that to me comes close to getting the colors and the feels of the landscape of the lower Mississippi River." He painted a base map of the river from St. Louis to the Gulf of Mexico. Separate maps break the river into sections. Note: black bears and white-tailed deer have been known to swim from one side of the river to the other. In 2010, Melanie Hill and Alex Mobley donned wetsuits and swam 1.5 miles across the Mississippi River, with Ruskie, who has performed the feat himself more than once, filming from a nearby rescue boat. Note: the Quapaw Canoe Company is named after the Quapaw people who inhabited the lower Mississippi River region. Quapaw is a Sioux word referring to the people who went downstream, as opposed to Omaha, which means the people who went upstream. The Quapaw and the Omaha were descended from the same Sioux-speaking group that lived in the Ohio River Valley. I've heard and read that a fog descended on the last of the Siouan peoples migrating down the Ohio, Ruskie said. They missed the Mississippi confluence in the fog and kept going south. Hence, they became the Quapaw, the downstream people. Another legend has it that when the tribe migrated down the Ohio and got to the Mississippi River, some chose to go upstream and some downstream. Regardless, Ruskie says he feels a kinship with the Quapaw since they preferred the lower Mississippi. Note: while relatively few people paddle the Mississippi, many anglers fish the river in motorboats. The fishing can be good if you know what to look for. The best action is often when the river is on a slow fall. When it's rising, the fish spread out and are less likely to bite. Try for catfish in areas where grain is loaded onto barges, such as Friars Point, Helena, Clarksdale, Rosedale, Greenville, and Mayersville. Catfish lurk near the bottom and will take worms or cut bait, or use large silver or gray crankbaits to catch white and striped bass in places where water spills over rock dikes. White bass feed in schools and typically weigh from 1/2 pound to 2 pounds. If you are after bream, head up oxbow lakes such as Lake Ferguson at Greenville and fish in the Willow Flats. The Lower Mississippi River Conservation Committee has an informative Mississippi River fishing guide that can be found at lmrcc.org. Oxbow Lakes. Scattered here and there along the Mississippi River are crescent-shaped oxbow lakes formed when old meanders were cut off from the main flow of the river. These oxbows are realms of sugarloaf bluffs, flat bean fields, cypress trees, and Spanish moss, of white egrets, plopping turtles, thrashing gar, and catfish rolling slowly over in the murk. Many fishermen drive considerable distances to the string of lakes that lie alongside the Mississippi, like the river's old footprints. Major oxbows from north to south include Moon Lake, DeSoto Lake, Lake Beulah, Lake Bolivar, Lake Ferguson at Greenville, Lake Lee, Lake Washington, Eagle Lake, plus nearby Chotard and Albemarle, and Lake Mary. And that's just in Mississippi. There are two categories of oxbow: those still connected with the river, if only seasonally, and those that are completely separate. Lake Mary and Chotard and Larto and Deer Park are still controlled by the river, so you have favorable conditions sometimes and unfavorable conditions sometimes, said oxbow fisherman Marty Bass of Pike County. St. John, Concordia, Bruin are separate from the river, so you have favorable conditions all year round for people who want fishing camps. They're cleaner lakes to me. They hardly ever get muddy. At Larto and Deer Park, people have no control. You can't go over there and build you a nice camp and plant you some St. Augustine grass and some yard plants and have it work. Every spring, the Mississippi River rises and spills over into the connected lakes via runouts or passes, recharging the fish population. While the water is high, catfishing is at its best, as anglers set trot lines in areas that are normally dry. In April or May, the river begins to drop, and the outflow of water stirs up the white perch, bream, and bass in those lakes. At least that's how it usually goes. Some years, to fishermen's dismay, the river stays up well into the summer. Mississippi River Towns. The northernmost portal to the Magnolia State's share of the Mississippi River is Mud Island Harbor at the foot of Beale Street in Memphis. As with most cities located on the riverbank, there are landings in the downtown vicinity. In fact, there are boat takeouts all along the river, but many are remote and seasonal, hard to find, and subject to flooding in high water. The surest stopping points are the cities of Helena, Arkansas, Mississippi's Rosedale, Greenville, Vicksburg, and Natchez, and St. Francisville, Louisiana. Downriver from Memphis, Tunica, Mississippi is the first town of any size. Although it's located several miles from the river, it has quite a presence by the water, with casinos and Tunica River Park, which includes a nature trail, observation tower, riverboat tours, and museum. Note: Tunica was named for the Tunica Indians, who fled their Delta home as settlers encroached in the 1700s and sought refuge in southwest Mississippi. The Houma Indians took them in, only to be massacred and driven south to the vicinity of modern-day Houma, Louisiana. The Tunicas took over their turf, including the portions of southwest Wilkinson County and adjoining Louisiana, now known as Tunica Hills. South of Tunica lies a former port town that was once both the county seat of Cahoma County and the largest cotton shipping port south of Memphis, Friars Point Landing. Although its heyday as a cotton port is long vanished, Friars Point remains one of the few sites in the Mississippi Delta with public access to the river. Friars Point is still alive and kicking, but the population is dwindling, and this once booming port may be headed for ghost town status. Probably the only thing keeping anyone's mind on Friars Point after the demise of King Cotton is the fact that numerous writers and musicians have referenced the town in their works, including William Faulkner, Tennessee Williams, Robert Johnson, Muddy Waters, and Sonny Boy Williamson. Friars Point is also the birthplace of famous country musician Conway Twitty. A little farther south along Highway 61, the famous Blues Highway, lies Clarksdale, Mississippi. The Delta Blues Museum there features photos, 78-speed records, old guitars, even a life-size figure of the late bluesman Muddy Waters. A chart lists blues musicians from towns and counties throughout the state. There's also a Delta Blues Archive and an after-school educational program oriented toward Mississippi Delta youth, but open to anybody. Local juke joints help keep the blues music alive with nightly live music offerings. About 50 meandering river miles downstream of Clarksdale, but barely 30 miles as the crow flies, is Rosedale, home of Great River Road State Park, which pays tribute to the historic route that parallels the river from its headwaters to the Gulf of Mexico. In Mississippi, the Great River Road follows Highway 61 in the north, picks up Highway 1 in the middle, then rejoins 61 through Vicksburg, Natchez, and into Louisiana. Farther south from Clarksdale, Greenville is home of the renowned Delta Blues Festival and the Hot Tamale Festival. Greenville is also known for its barbecue. Just follow the smell of hickory smoke. Another former port town of note is Mayersville. Originally known as Gibson's Landing, this spot south of Greenville was a hub for cotton speculators, saloon owners and patrons, riverboat gamblers, and showboat thespians throughout the 1800s. After the historic flood of 1927, a newly built flood control structure cut the town off from the river and ended its status as a port. Mayersville is also notable because it was there in the 1970s that civil rights activist, politician, and diplomat Eunita Blackwell became the first black female mayor of a city in Mississippi. Vicksburg lies at the southern end of the floodplain that is typically called the Mississippi Delta and at the northern end of the Lois, fine, crumbly soil bluffs section of the river. The city is perched atop a bluff, which made it nearly impregnable during the Civil War. It took a tremendous amount of force and strategy before General Ulysses S. Grant's troops could capture it. Vicksburg National Military Park and Cemetery tells the story, and also features a display of the USS Cairo, a Union ironclad vessel sunk during the war and later raised and restored. Note: Vicksburg has a working scale model replica of the Mississippi River and beautiful murals on the flood wall. Plus, there's the Biedenharn Coca-Cola Museum, located in the building where Coke was first bottled in 1894. Grand Gulf Military State Park, 30 miles downriver near Port Gibson, provides a fascinating history of the area as well as a campground. There's a public boat ramp a few miles from the park in the Claiborne County Port, along with the Grand Gulf Nuclear Power Plant. Ghost Towns and Ruins. Between Port Gibson and Natchez, old county roads leading west of Highway 61 take sightseers deep into the past. The roads sometimes seem more like creeks, narrow, crooked, uneven, with steep banks and leafy ceilings. Like creeks, they once led ultimately to the Mississippi River. But the big river has long since moved west, leaving historical wonders behind, like the village of Rodney, the ruins of Windsor, and the Greek Revival Bethel Presbyterian Church. Windsor was a magnificent mansion overlooking the Mississippi River when it still ran under the edge of these bluffs. The river is now more than 2 miles to the west, having changed course in the 1800s, as rivers are wont to do. A short distance away on the more modern Highway 552, north of Alcorn State University, stands Bethel Presbyterian Church, built in 1845 in Greek Revival architectural style. Its faded white walls give it a ghostly Gothic look. The church is open to the public, with a guest register and plenty of brochures in the foyer. Beyond is a stark sanctuary with concrete floors, old pews, and a piano. Rodney was once considered a riverside town with commercial potential equal to that of Baton Rouge, until the river shifted away, leaving the community high and dry. Dr. Rush Nutt of Rodney ushered in the era of Southern dominance in the cotton industry when he invented the steam-powered cotton gin. Note, fire seems to be the natural enemy of antebellum homes. Windsor survived the Civil War, but burnt in 1890 when someone dropped a cigarette. The only things left are 23 gigantic Corinthian columns amid the deep woods. Dr. Rush Nutt's Rodney home, named Laurel Hill, stood till 1982, when it burned while being restored. Another of Rodney's claims to fame was Oakland College, the first U.S. college south of Tennessee to confer a liberal arts baccalaureate degree. It operated for more than 30 years until it was shut down during the Civil War. After the war, Oakland College was never reopened, but it gave birth to two institutions that lasted through the 20th century and beyond: historically black Alcorn University, now Alcorn State, and Chamberlain Hunt Academy. Note, Chamberlain Hunt Academy at Port Gibson had a long tenure as a military boarding school with a reputation for academic excellence. Several famous alumni, including Louisiana Governor John Parker and Olympic runner Donald Scott, matriculated at Chamberlain Hunt, as did a couple of notably infamous, by association, alumni: Lee Harvey Oswald's brother and stepbrother. After the JFK assassination, Chamberlain Hunt Academy made it abundantly clear in a public statement that Lee Oswald himself had never attended school there. The road from Port Gibson to Rodney takes a long downhill plunge through eroded, vine-covered Lois Bluffs to what is now almost a ghost town. To the left stands an old house next to a boarded-up country store with an old-timey rusted gas pump. Up ahead to the left, beyond a pasture, a white vine-covered brick building looms hollow-eyed over on a lane leading to an old white church with a rounded metal cupola roof. No sign identifies it, and the church looks abandoned. Off to the right stand more sagging buildings, a large camp house with a screened-in porch and barking dog, and the original Rodney Presbyterian Church. The brick building once faced the Mississippi River, but now gazes sadly at shacks and willow thickets. Although the church is privately owned, it's on the National Register of Historic Places and the Windsor Battlefield Tour, and several markers around it tell the story. French explorers on the Mississippi River called the spot Petty Gulf, distinct from Grand Gulf a short distance to the north. It was settled in the late 1700s and incorporated as Rodney in 1828 after territorial judge Thomas Rodney. The Presbyterian Church was built that same year. Located advantageously with a riverboat landing, the town grew to encompass 35 stores, a bank, a newspaper, and 500 residents. Note: in September 1863, during the Civil War, the Union gunboat USS Rattler anchored offshore, and the Presbyterian pastor invited its men to church. The captain and 18 crew members attended. A local Confederate cavalry heard about the visit, rode in, and captured the men. When news reached the Rattler, the remaining crewmen began bombarding the town. The rebels sent word they'd hang the prisoners if the shelling didn't stop, and the Rattler backed off. A cannonball remains lodged in the church's front wall to this day. Union troops got their revenge the following year by plundering Rodney. But that same winter, the USS Rattler was driven aground in Grand Gulf by a strong wind and sank. Cholera and yellow fever dealt Rodney serious blows in the 1850s, and then came the Civil War in the 1860s. In the aftermath of the war, a sandbar formed in the Mississippi River, diverting its course to the west. Things went downhill for Rodney from there. In 1869, fire swept through the town, destroying most of its buildings. When a railroad came through well to the east in the 1880s, Rodney lost all commercial appeal and was officially abolished in 1930. Now the main industries are farming and hunting, judging by the number of camps scattered around the area and the big farms farther on. A gravel road continues south of town along the edge of the bluffs toward the Potkopanew Trail segment of the old sunken Natchez Trace. Potkopanew is a Natchez Indian word for little valley. Off to the west of this severely rutted gravel road stretches a vast farm field that was once the bottom of the Mississippi River. Note: north of Rodney and west of Port Gibson once lay Bruinsburg, built in the 1700s by an Irish settler at the confluence of Bayou Pierre and the Mississippi River. Little Bruinsburg would play a big role in the Civil War when General Grant crossed the Mississippi River there with 20,000 Union soldiers to besiege the Gibraltar of the Confederacy at Vicksburg. Within 2 years of Grant's landing, the once prominent port town of Bruinsburg was abandoned. Now it lies on private land, and the only remaining reference to it is a historical marker on Church Street in Port Gibson that reads, "Bruinsburg, about 14 miles west at the mouth of Bayou Pierre, is the old river port settled by Peter Bryan Bruin in 1788. It was visited by Aaron Burr in 1807. Grant landed there in the Vicksburg Campaign of 1863. Old Natchez.
Like Vicksburg, Natchez stands on a towering bluff with only a narrow strip called Natchez Under the Hill situated by the water below the bluff. The downtown area and Natchez Under the Hill maintain a historic feel with carriage rides, antebellum homes, and other old buildings. Old Natchez is a lot like the New Orleans French Quarter, but without the big city feel. Founded by the French in 1716, Natchez is actually 2 years older than New Orleans, though of course Native Americans lived here long before there was a town. Note: the original European-descended American settlement at what is now Natchez was known as Fort Rosalie, established in 1716 and renamed some 15 years later. The name Natchez is derived from the name of the dominant Native American tribe that inhabited the area at the time of the Spanish and French explorers. An early gazetteer states that the name refers to the Sunset Tribe, but that and other etymologies such as to break off, or running man, or salty, are now considered unlikely. In frontier days, Natchez Under the Hill was a mile wide and bustling with commerce. Now the Mississippi River here has crept eastward, 400 yards since 1800, leaving only a narrow strip of land with a couple of restaurants, a gift shop, a saloon, some old buildings, and a public boat ramp. A riverboat casino is usually docked here as well. Up on the bluff, the town does a brilliant job of showcasing the river with the Natchez Trail along the bluff. The paved walkway along the top of the 200-foot-tall bluff offers sweeping views of the river and the Louisiana lowlands. The walkway is lined with benches and historical markers and beautiful old crepe myrtles. At each end, the trail drops down to a lower path at the base of the bluff so you can walk a loop. At the south end is a park on the bluff with benches, picnic tables, and live oak trees where people sit in the shade soaking in the river view and breeze. To the south stretches the Highway 84 bridge. Note: across the river from Natchez, Vidalia, Louisiana has its own river walk closer to the water's edge. Vidalia was the setting of a notorious frontier fight when Jim Bowie killed Major Norris Wright in an 1827 sandbar duel that escalated into a brawl, leaving two men dead and two seriously wounded. Both Bowie and his knife gained nationwide fame from the incident. Deep history. Looking out from the bluffs above Natchez under the hill, it's possible to imagine how far floodwaters extended in pre-levee days, or even in post-levee days when the man-made banks couldn't hold back the waters, such as in the Great Flood of 1927. One of the most gripping accounts of such conditions is in the appendix to Mark Twain's Life on the Mississippi, where he presents newspaper accounts of the flood of 1882, when waters extended from Natchez to Catahoula Lake, Louisiana, more than 50 miles away. A look at a map makes this understandable. The Red River flows southeast across Louisiana, absorbing the Black, which in turn has gathered the Washita, Tensaw, and Little Rivers, among others. Whenever the Mississippi River would flood, all these streams did the same, forming a sheet of brown water from the Mississippi bluffs all the way to the edge of the piney hills in central Louisiana. Reading about the human tragedy resulting from such floods makes it easy to understand why society has tried to master the Mississippi River with levees, dredging, and other projects. Native Americans, like the Natchez Indians, made far smaller but nonetheless lasting changes to the landscape by building mounds. The Natchez Indians first enter recorded history in the 1540s when they made Hernando de Soto's fearsome gold-seeking Spanish explorers flee like scalded dogs. The Spaniards, so mighty on shore with their blunderbusses, armor, and war dogs, were out of their element on the water, where the Indians could harass their cumbersome boats with hundreds of swift dugout canoes. The Natchez chief, Quigwaltum, left no doubt as to his tribe's military superiority when his navy chased the Spaniards downstream and out of Natchez territory, which then stretched from modern-day Greenville to Fort Adams. In 1699, Pierre Lemoyne, Sieur d'Iberville, arrived and found the countryside settled by native inhabitants, with fields, roads, and hamlets. By this time, the Natchez Indians were much diminished by the advent of European illnesses. By the end of the 17th century, some 4,000 Natchez lived in about 10 villages east of the modern-day town, ruled by the Great Sun, who lived in a 45-by-25-foot cabin on a 10-foot-high earth mound. The French settled in the midst of them, farming and trading. By 1729, some 400 Frenchmen and 200 Africans were living around what is now the town of Natchez. The once mighty Natchez Indians found themselves in a subservient position. That made for inevitable tensions, and when they arose, the French responded with an iron fist. In November 1729, the Natchez rose up and massacred the settlers. Their uprising encouraged the Yazoo Indians upriver to do the same on a smaller scale. These massacres were as shocking to the French as the September 11, 2001 terrorist attacks were to modern Americans, and the French reacted much as the Americans did after 9/11, by going on the attack. From then on, as far as French military officials were concerned, the only good Natchez was a dead one. And because the French had numerous allies among other Indian tribes, such as the Choctaw and the Tunica, the Natchez were in dire peril. Knowing they were no longer safe in their home villages on the Mississippi River, they fled in various directions. A large contingent built a fort near Sicily Island, Louisiana, to await the inevitable reprisal by the French. The French arrived in January 1731 in the midst of a cold, wet winter. Over the ensuing days, after many skirmishes and negotiations, some Natchez escaped while the rest surrendered. In the end, the French left with a few hundred prisoners. The remaining Natchez scattered across the South and ceased to exist as a distinct linguistic group. Their mounds still stand, along with a museum and replicas of their houses, at the Grand Village of the Natchez Indians off Highway 61 in Natchez. A living link remains in the form of the popular powwows held at Grand Village every spring. These powwows are based on the customs of the Southern Plains Indians, not southeastern tribes such as the Natchez, but most tribes do gather for various ceremonies, festivals, and dances. Wild Country. South of Natchez lie St. Catherine Creek National Wildlife Refuge, the mouth of the Homochitta River, the flatlands around Lake Mary, and the mouth of the Buffalo River. The Buffalo used to spread out into a series of lakes east of Lake Mary, but somewhere along the line it turned north into the old Homochitta River, which was the channel of the Homochitta River until the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers rerouted it to the Mississippi in 1938. The old Homochitta empties into Lake Mary, itself an old oxbow channel of the Mississippi. Below the mouth of the Buffalo looms the majestic bluff where Fort Adams once stood. The bluff was visited by French explorer Robert de La Salle, who began his famous expedition down the Mississippi River in February 1682 from what is now Illinois. After 44 days, he reached the mouth of the Red River, and on March 29th, Father Zenobius Mombray held Easter Mass on the high bluff on the east side of the Mississippi River, the first definite record of a Christian service in Mississippi. La Salle proceeded to the mouth of the river, and in 1698, Jesuit missionaries from Quebec arrived at Fort Adams to work among the Homa Indians, building a chapel on Blockhouse Hill, as the bluff was later called. The church was abandoned in the early 1700s, but in 1706, Father Antoine Davion, a missionary among the Tunica Indians on the Yazoo River, moved to Fort Adams. He built a new chapel on the same spot as the first church and stayed until 1722, when the Capuchins, a French missionary legion, took over the work in the southern part of the Mississippi Valley. For years, the bluff was referred to as La Roche à Davion, French for the Rock of Davion, in honor of Father Davion. The high bluff also served as a military site. Forts Prudhomme and Assumption for the French, Fort Ferdinand for the Spanish, and Fort Adams for the United States. Fort Adams was the site of several treaties, negotiations, conspiracies, and battles. In the Civil War, the Union stationed its gunboat, USS Chillicothe, on the river to defeat Confederate attempts to take the hill. After the war, the adjacent town thrived until the Mississippi River channel began swinging west. Now the fort is gone, the river is 2 miles away, and the village of Fort Adams, located on Highway 24 about 20 miles west of Woodville, barely exists. Steamboat Quest. North of Fort Adams is a small lake marking the 1994 excavation site of a sunken steamboat. On May 8, 1837, the northbound vessel Ben Sherrod was engaged in a midnight race with another steamboat when it exploded and sank, killing an undetermined number of people. In addition to a cargo of cypress and cotton, records indicated a large number of coins was on board the vessel, as well as numerous items of historical interest. Built in 1835, early in steamboating history, the 393-ton sidewheel steamboat measured 153 feet 9 inches long and 27 feet wide. While later steamboat models had lightweight hulls with flat bottoms and timbers well apart, the Ben Sherrod had curved sides and huge side timbers closely spaced, comparable to an ocean-going ship. History buff James Moore of Woodville first heard about the Ben Sherrod as a 15-year-old boy, he told the Macomb Enterprise Journal in a 1994 interview. In 1980, he began a search for the site and eventually found it east of the Mississippi River, which had shifted course over the years and left the wreck buried under silt. Led by Moore and backed by the Penelor Corporation of Columbus, Mississippi, work got underway on the archaeological excavation in 1994. To do the digging, a huge dragline crane with a 6-cubic-yard bucket was shipped by barge to the riverbank below Fort Adams and walked overland to the site, which is over a mile from the Mississippi River. The excavation saw numerous setbacks, including frequent flooding of the site by shallow water tables in the Mississippi River floodplain. In 2000, the vessel was found 70 feet deep in the mud, upside down, and exploded. Shortly after reaching the remains, Moore died of a heart attack while operating a backhoe at the worksite. The excavation, which continued for years, uncovered a keg of nails, a couple boxes of augers, wood drill bits, and some ceramics. The quest has since been abandoned. It remains unknown if the stash of coins was ever found. Note: across the river from Fort Adams stands a Corps of Engineers structure at Old River, Louisiana. The Red River, having absorbed all the water North Louisiana has to offer, joins the Atchafalaya River just 7 miles from the Mississippi, linked by Old River. Since the Atchafalaya provides a shorter route to the sea, if left on its own, it could become the main Mississippi River channel. So, in 1963, the Corps built the Old River structure to control the Mississippi's flow into the Atchafalaya and provide an emergency outlet for floodwaters. During serious floods, a spillway at Morganza, Louisiana, can also be used to take pressure off the Mississippi. In 1987, the Corps added another structure near Vidalia, Louisiana. Even with all this, there is no guarantee the Mississippi River won't someday change course. Mississippi waterfalls. Just downriver from Fort Adams, Clark Creek tumbles out of rugged hills known as the Devil's Backbone. The woods around the mouth of the creek are posted by a hunting club, but a short distance inland is Clark Creek Natural Area, which features waterfalls up to 20 feet tall, rugged hills and hollows, lush forest, abundant wildlife, clear streams, and bizarre clay formations. The state has built gravel walkways with wooden stairs and bridges, benches, and observation posts. Clark Creek Natural Area has been through a lot of changes since the state purchased the property in the late 1970s. The natural area was established in 1978 as a joint effort of the Mississippi Wildlife Heritage Committee, the Nature Conservancy, the International Paper Company, the Bureau of Outdoor Recreation, David Bramlett, and the Wilkinson County Board of Supervisors and Education. As use increased, erosion on the clay trails worsened and litter mounted, with a mini garbage dump springing up near the entrance and beer cans left around the waterfalls. In the early 1980s, the Mississippi Department of Wildlife, Fisheries, and Parks took action. In 1982, the department posted regulations that banned camping, fires, rappelling, tree cutting, off-road vehicles, off-trail hiking, and firearms outside hunting seasons. In 1983, volunteers from the University of Southern Mississippi spread gravel on the trail, built wooden bridges, and installed wooden steps on steep slopes. Garbage cans were also placed in the parking area. In 1996, the trail system was totally revamped, with fresh gravel, new bridges, stairs, observation posts, benches, even a swing at the overlook. The trail was extended, outhouses were added, and later a bathroom facility. There are even maps on stands along the path that show not only the layout, but the location of waterfalls. According to the map, the 700-acre area has 11 waterfalls, though the Wildlife Department website claims there are 50. It probably depends on the definition of waterfall. Note: Clark Creek Natural Area is home to at least 3 record trees, a world record Mexican plum and bigleaf snowbell, and a state record hop hornbeam. The first waterfall on the trail is one of the best, tall and wide. Clark Creek itself is shallow, and in the summer people wade and play amid the echo of crashing water, the smell of wet clay, and the lush growth of ferns, moss, and other wet plants. It's tempting to follow the creek from here down, but that's not advisable due to the highly fragile nature of the soil. Instead, gravel trails lead over the hills with spurs down to the waterfalls. The main trail ends at a tributary to Clark Creek, where there's a cluster of waterfalls. A rarely used dirt path continues across the creek to form a 4-mile loop. Adventure on the River by Ernest Herndon. Joey Cargill's trip down the Mississippi illustrates the challenges the big river poses to modern paddlers. In 2020, the 41-year-old Cargill of Gretna, Louisiana, floated the entire river in a wooden canoe. A pilot on ocean-going ships in the Mississippi River, Cargill had already traveled the world, lived overseas, run with the bulls in Pamplona, and climbed the pyramids, among many other adventures. Since boyhood, he had wanted to canoe the Mississippi. At age 10, he had even drawn up a detailed itinerary of a trip. He finally got his chance. Equipped with a 73-year-old wooden canoe, Cargill launched in the headwaters at Lake Itasca, Minnesota, on May 31, 2020, following the plan he had drawn up as a boy. But things went bad from the get-go. The river was so low he had to drag the boat most of the first 30 miles, punching 3 holes in the hull the first day.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.